I want to welcome you all to another lecture on design of combined footing. In our previous lecture video, we discussed some basic concepts related to the geometry and load transfer mechanism of combined footing. And in today's lecture video, we will see and we will study the design of an eccentric footing with strap beam. And today's design, we will see through some manual design methods, that is, we will use an Excel sheet for the design of strap footing and eccentric footing with strap beam. And in our next lecture, we will look at the same design through the use of CSI Safe software. So if you see on your screen, we have two columns here, column A and column B. Column B is located attached to the property line. That's why we have to design an eccentric footing for this column B. And column A is a concentrically loaded column, and for this we will only design a single isolated footing for column A. So the distance between the center of column A and center of column B is S, and the distance between the center of this footing on the left and the center of this footing on the right is S1, is represented in this diagram. B is the width of the footing for both concentric and eccentric footing, whereas the length is L1 for concentric footing and L2 for eccentric footing. We will come to these symbols once again. So our design of eccentric footing with strap beam, it's mainly divided into two parts. In the first part, we will look at the design of the footing part, that is the design of this footing slab. And in our second part, we will look at the design of this strap beam. So let's start with the design of footing part. Let's see what are the loading conditions for our footing. These loading conditions, or the value of these loads, are derived from the ETAPS model. Once you construct a model and analyze a model, the reactions coming on the base of our structure can be derived from ETAPS. And I have taken these axial loads and moment from the ETAPS itself. Here column A is the exterior footing, or you can say this is an interior column, and column B is an exterior column which is attached to the property line. So remember that. So these are the loads that are coming onto our columns, and these are all our service loads. That means there is no load factor attached to these loads. So the axial load coming on column A is 468.77 kilonewton. Axial load on column B is 336.1082 kilonewton. And then we have moment about x-axis and y-axis for both column A and column B. These moments are very small as compared to the axial load that is coming onto these columns. Hence, we will not use these moment values. We will not incorporate these moment values in the design of this footing. We will only use the axial load. So our axial load on column A is, column A, that is this interior column, is 468, and then the axial load on column B is 336, and both of these are service loads. Now let's look at the column size and configuration. Ours is a square column, both A and B, of dimension 300 mm by 300 mm, and this value of S which we discussed here, the center to center distance between these two columns is 4.064 meter, and the clear cover for our footing we will take is 50 millimeter. So this is our column size and configuration. All of these data are known to us, or we can extract this data. And finally, if we look at soil and material properties, our safe bearing capacity of the soil is 100 kilonewton per meter square. Our concrete grade is 20 megapascal, and our steel rebar grade is 500 megapascal. So these are our information that are available to us. The loads coming onto the columns, the size and distance of the columns, and then the soil and material properties. Now the first step that we follow while designing of eccentric footing is the computation of the dimensions of the footing. That means fixing the geometry of the footing. And as we discussed in our previous lecture, when we looked at some basic concepts regarding the design of footing, combined footing, we discussed one point there, which said that If you see here, if you look at this first point, the geometry of the footing base should preferably be so selected as to ensure that the centroid of the footing area coincides with the resultant of the column loads. So this condition one is one that we must fulfill while designing the geometry of the combined footing. Since our eccentric footing with strap beam also is a combined footing, we have to ensure that this condition is satisfied. So how do we satisfy this condition? Let's look here. First, we suppose that the self-weight of footing and surcharge is 15% of total vertical load. So add this vertical load 468 plus 336 and calculate 15% of this summation, then you get the value of self-weight and surcharge. So 15%, this value is 15% of total vertical load. That means 15% of load on column A plus load on column B. And then total load you get is the load on column A plus load on column B plus this self-weight of footing and surcharge 120 plus 0.73. So if we add these three loads, you get the value to be 925.60 kilonewton. So after calculating the total load, if you divide the total load by safe bearing capacity of our soil, which is 100 kilonewton per meter square, so our required footing area comes out to be 9.25 meter square. Now let us assume that the width of our footing be 2.25 meter. This width is the same for both interior column and eccentric column as well. So if you take the width to be 2.25 meter, let us suppose that the length of these two footings are L1 and L2. L1 for the interior footing and L2 for the eccentric footing. Then the footing area is given by B multiplied times L1 plus L2. So B multiplied times L1 plus L2 is equal to 9.25. We have supposed the value of B to be 2.25 meter. Then you get the value of L1 plus L2 to be 4.11 meter. So now that you have got the summation of the required length of two footings, now it's time to calculate the length of individual footing, that is L1 and L2. So previously we dealt with our condition that the centroid of the load resultant should coincide with the centroid of the area of the footing. So for that, let us first calculate the centroid of loads. To calculate the centroid of loads, assume that this centroid is located at a distance of x bar from column A. So if this is column A here and column B here, let us suppose that the centroid acts at a distance of x bar from A. Now after supposing this distance is x bar, you can use the formula to calculate x bar and y bar. Y bar means the centroid of the load in the y direction. This y bar, if we suppose that we have axis x here and axis y here, then y bar will be 0 since this footing is eccentric only in the x direction. For x bar, you can use the formula. You can take the moment of the loads about column A so that the load acting on column A, PA into distance will be 0 since we are taking moment about A point itself, plus the load acting on column B, PB into this S distance. This S means 4.064. That is the center to center distance between these two columns divided by PA plus PB. So if you use this formula, we have the value of PA, PB and S. You can get the value of X bar, which comes out to be 1.69 meter. So the centroid of these loads on column A and B lies at a distance of 1.65 meter from this column A. Now we have got the centroid of the loads. Now we assume that this centroid of loads coincide with the centroid of the area of footing. So now take the moment of footing area about the center of column A. For that you can use this formula here. In this formula, right hand side you have total area into CZ distance. Total area means area of this footing here, this interior footing, and the area of the eccentric footing. The total area you have got here, 9.25 meter square. This is the total area. And CZ distance means this X bar value that we just got, 1.69 meter. So you have got the right hand side here. Now on the left hand side, this will be your value of the moment of footing area about column A. This means B into L2. B into L2 is the area of this eccentric footing. Now the distance will be this S plus half column width, this point, plus 1/2 L2. 1/2 L2 means since the centroid of this footing lies here and this value is 1/2 L2. So if you use this formula here, the only unknown in this equation is L2. And if you put all the known values, that is B, S, half column width, total area, CZ distance, then the only unknown in this equation will be L2. And this equation, if you rearrange the terms in this equation, you get this equation is quadratic in L2, where the value of coefficients A, B, and C will be got. These will be the values of the coefficient A, B, and C. Now use the quadratic equation formula to get the value of L2, that is minus B plus minus root under B square minus 4AC by 2A. If you use this formula, you get two values of L2, 2.24 and 6.17. And if you substitute the value of L2 in this equation here, L1 plus L2 equals to 4.11 meter. Then you get two values of L1, 1.87 and minus 2.06. So since the length dimension cannot be negative, we neglect or we do not accept this minus 2.06 and its corresponding L2 value 6.17. So finally we get the values of L2 is 2.24 meter and L1 is 1.87 meter. Hence, the final size of the footing adopted for design is L1 1.87 meter, L2 2.24 meter, and breadth 2.25 meter. So we have got the dimensions of our footing. Remember, we assumed the value of B first and then we derived the values of L1 and L2. If these values are not proportionate, for example, if you choose a very small value of B here, then you may get a very large value of L1 and L2. So in that case, you can follow these steps once again or make the calculations for a second time and then get proportionate values for L1, L2 and B. So after getting the values of L1, L2 and B, the dimensions of our footing is fixed. So now after the fixing of the geometry of the footing, now let us come to calculating the reaction forces and then the calculation of depth and reinforcement of our footing slab. So we have come to the fifth step here, computation of reactions. To find the reactions here, first let us see here some horizontal width of column in eccentric footing. Our column is a square column of size 0.30 meter. So this horizontal width of eccentric column will also be 0.30 meter. Now eccentricity will be half of L2. This means this is half of L2 up to here minus horizontal width of column in eccentric footing divided by 2. That means from this dimension here, you have to subtract this half of the column width to get the eccentricity. Doing that, you get eccentricity as L2 value we have got here. If you go up, L2 value 2.24 minus 0.3 by 2, you get 0.97 meter. So 2.24 divided by 2 minus 0.30 by 2, 0.97 meter is the eccentricity in x direction. And after getting the eccentricity, you can get the value of S1. S1 means this S minus this eccentricity. So you get S is the center to center distance, 4.064 meter minus 0.97, you get 3.094 meter. After this, remember that we calculated the area of our fitting based on service loads. Now, to get the ultimate loads, because we have to find the ultimate bending moment and reinforcement based on ultimate loads. So to find the ultimate loads, whatever value of service loads you have in this table, multiply each value by 1.5, which is the factor of safety or load factor, to get the ultimate load. So after multiplying the service load at column A by 1.5, you get its ultimate load. Similarly, multiply the service load at column B by 1.5, you get the ultimate load for column B. In this way, calculate ultimate load for both columns A and B for both axial and moment loads, although we are not using moment here. Now, after calculating the ultimate load, we have to find the shear force and bending moment that is acting on our footing slab to calculate its depth. And the way to do that is that if you see a diagram here, what I have done here is, first let us calculate the reaction forces acting on our footing slab. So let me draw a simple diagram here. Suppose I want to represent this whole footing by a simple beam. And here, under this center of column A, we have our ultimate load, ultimate axial load of column A acting, PUA, which value we have got in this table here. Similarly, at the center of this footing, column load, PUB is acting. And then, the reaction forces on this footing is acting at the center of this footing area in the upward direction. For example, the center of this column here and the center of this footing area coincide. So our reaction it is just acting here in the same line of action as PUA. But in case of this eccentric footing, the center of this footing area lies somewhere here. So our reaction at B will be acting RB. So considering this simplified force body diagram, you can have two equations of equilibrium. First is the summation of forces in x direction is zero and the summation of forces in y direction is zero. So this PUA plus PUB should be equal to RA and RB, which is our first equation of equilibrium. We took RB to the right hand side here. And similarly, if you take moment of all these forces about this point here, then you get RB is equal to PUB into S divided by S1. S and S1 value we have got here, because the anticlockwise moment given by RB into this distance should be equal to the clockwise given moment given by PUB into this distance. So PUB into S1 is equal to RB into S. Rearranging the terms, you get RB value as PUB into S by S1. Substitute the value of RB from second equation into first, you get the equation for RA. Now RA is equal to PUA plus PUB minus PUB into S by S1. So we have the value of this PUA and PUB, which are the ultimate loaded column A and B, and S and S1 value also we have got here. Use these values, get the value of RA, which we get to be 545.09 kN. And RV we get to be 662.22 kN. Now these reaction forces are acting as point load. We want to convert these into uniform loading. To do that, To find the uniform loading for RA, divide this 545.09 kN by length L1, which we have already got, and divide the RB by length L2. We get the reaction forces in terms of uniform loading. Now, after getting the reaction forces, we will draw the bending moment and shear force diagram. To get the value of bending moment and shear force, for which we have to design our footing slab and our strap beam. So let me erase this here first. So now if you see the diagram here, this is the simple diagram that I just erased, and you can see here the same thing. At point A and point B, we have the ultimate load from column coming into the vertical horizontal direction in the downward direction, the 703.156 and 504.162, and in the upward direction is uniform swell pressure. This uniform load that we just calculated are acting in upward direction. For example, over the length of the footing for interior column, this 291.49 kilonewton meter uniform loading is acting as swell pressure in the upward direction, and this 295.63 uniform loading is acting along the length of this exterior column in the upward direction. And this is the beam part here. This is this gap here. Now we have this free body diagram. Using this free body diagram, you can calculate bending moment and shear forces along this beam here. We have assumed this as a simply supported beam, and we have the forces acting on our beam. Using these forces, you can calculate the bending moment and shear force diagram. Bending moment and shear force diagram, you can either model this beam element in any finite element software like ETAPS and SAP 2000 and get the bending moment and shear force diagram, or you may calculate those internal forces by yourself also. I have modeled this beam in ETAPS and SAP. I will teach you this modeling, how to get this someday in any upcoming video. But for this lecture, what I did was I modeled this beam element and I applied these forces here and got the bending moment and shear force diagram. And this was the bending moment diagram that I obtained here. Let's look here. So this is the bending moment diagram. You can see here 118.05 kilonewton meter is the bending moment diagram for column A. It's acting in this line. And for column B, you see that our maximum moment is 289.97. So these are the value of ultimate bending moment that we got for this column A at this point here, and column B maximum bending moment at this point here. You can see that the bending moment is positive for this interior column part here, and the bending moment, maximum bending moment, is negative for this eccentric footing here. So we consider these two moments, 118.05 kilonewton meter for column A and 289.97 newton meter for column B. Now after getting this bending moment, we have a formula to find the depth of our footing. This is the formula: square root of ultimate bending moment divided by 0.133 fck into b. fck is the characteristic strength of concrete, and this ultimate bending moment is the value that we obtain from this bending moment diagram. And this formula, if you want to see where this formula is, you can go to SP16. Go to SP16, and in that SP16, look at table C. Table C has limiting moment of resistance and reinforcement index given for singly reinforced concrete rectangular sections. And this 0.133 coefficient that you see here, this is for FE 500 grade steel. If you use a different grade steel, then this formula's coefficient value will also be different. For now, Since ours is a Fe500 grid steel, we have assumed that this is the value of the depth of footing. So now for depth of footing under column A, in this formula, use the ultimate bending moment value 118.05, you get depth as 140.44 mm. And for column B, this is B here, use the ultimate bending moment value 289.97 and you get 220.11 mm. So you got this effective depth of footing. Now to calculate the total depth, consider that we are using 16 mm dia bars in our footing, then the overall depth will be depth from bending, which is this effective depth that we got here, plus bar diameter divided by 2 plus clear cover. Clear cover we have assumed as 50 mm. So 50 plus 16 by 2 means 8, plus for A 140.44 and for B 220.11, we get the value of total depth for footing under column A is 198.44 mm, and under column B is 278.11 mm. So this is the value of depth that we get from the consideration of bending. Now after getting the value of depth, we have to calculate reinforcement required. And to calculate the required reinforcement, you have the formula here, AST required. I will not go into detail about these formulas since this you have already learned in your undergraduate course in reinforced concrete design. We have all the values that we require here, Fck, Fy, ultimate bending moment, effective depth, width, everything we have here. Use these values, then you get the reinforcement under column A is 2382.44 mm², and under column B 3733.63 mm². So if you use 12 number of 16 dia rod, you get 2413.71, which is greater than 2382, hence okay. And if you get use 19 number of 16 mm dia bars, 3821.71, which is greater than 3733, okay. We have used 16 mm dia bars because we have adopted 16 mm dia bar when calculating overall depth here, so remember that. So these are the value of reinforcement that we get for our footing based on the bending moment criteria. And the depth also we have got from the bending moment criteria. Now let us check this depth from 2A shear criteria. Now you can see here, I have posted here the shear force diagram for the same beam that we discussed above. We discussed about bending moment diagram for depth during to derive depth from bending. Now we need shear force diagram to derive depth from 2A and 1A shear. So depth check from 2A shear is generally checked at a distance of dy2 from the face of the column. dy2 from the face of the column. However, for easiness and for economical section, we are considering the maximum shear force, which is from this shear force diagram, you can see the maximum shear force is 380.19 for column A, and it may not be clear here, 414.29 for column B. You can go to your ETABS or SAFE software and scroll for values at a distance of dy2 also, but for now we are using this maximum shear force 380.19 and 414.29. So this is our ultimate shear force under column A and column B. Now for 2A shear check, you have to go to this IS code section 31.6.3.1 in IS 456, where it says that when shear reinforcement is not provided, the calculated shear stress at the critical section should not exceed Ks into tau c. This is the statement of clause 31.6.3.1. So Ks means 0.5 plus beta c, where beta c is the ratio of shorter side of column to longer side. So since our shorter and longer side are the same, the value of beta c will be 1 and 1. So Ks will be 1.5 and 1.5 for both columns A and B. But what our code says is that the value of Ks cannot be greater than 1. So since 1.5 is greater than 1, we adopt the values 1 itself. And tau c value, we got the value of Ks here, and now tau c value is 0.25 root under fck. Root under fck is root under 20. So we get tau c value 1.11, 1.11, and hence Ks into tau c is 1 into 1.11 is 1.11 and 1.11 for both A and B footings. Now, since we do not provide shear reinforcement in our footing slab, we have to make sure that our calculated shear stress should not exceed Ks into tau c. That means should not exceed 1.11 Newton per mm square. So let's look at that. Now, to do that, first let us adopt the depth to satisfy punching shear under column A and column B. I have assumed the depth is 350 mm here. We got the depth from bending is 198 and 278. So if our design is governed by two-way shear, then this depth may not be sufficient. In that case, we have to assume higher depth for our footings when we are checking the depth for two-way shear. So I have chosen the starting values of 350 mm for both footing under column A and footing under column B. Or if our design is governed by bending, then this depth may be sufficient itself also. So let us suppose that our depth to satisfy punching shear under column A is 350 mm and 350 mm. You can choose any lesser value or greater value also. Now, the perimeter of critical section under column A. You know how to find this perimeter? For example, if this is our column, then our perimeter for critical section lies at a distance of d by 2 from the face of the column. So our perimeter will be, this will also be d by 2, this will also be d by 2, and this will also be d by 2. So since this is our perimeter for critical section, we can write 2 times this width of column, let's call this w for now, plus d by 2 plus d by 2 means d, plus again 2 sides in another direction, 2 times plus width of column plus d. Since our width of column is same in both directions, you can directly write this 4 times width of column plus depth of footing. So this is the way to find the critical perimeter for critical section. And we get, since our depth is the same and our width of the column is also same for both footings, but both A and B, we get the same perimeter of critical section, 1401.2 mm. Now let us calculate nominal shear stress developed for footing. And this nominal shear stress is calculated as this ultimate shear force that we got here, 380.19 and 414.29. So use the formula, ultimate shear force divided by the perimeter, critical perimeter that we obtained here, into the depth of our footing. So our P and D is same for both footings A and B. Only difference is the ultimate shear force. So use this formula, you get the nominal shear stress developed under column A is 0.77 and column B is 0.84. So let's see here. This nominal shear stress that is developed in both footings A and B is less than 1.11 in both cases. Hence, the footing is safe against two-way shear. Let me show something here. If I were to change this adopted depth to 300 mm in both cases, now look here, this nominal shear stress developed under column A is still okay, 1.05, which is less than 1.11. But for footing under column B, the nominal shear stress value developed would exceed the allowable value. So you can see that although 300 mm depth is sufficient for footing under column A, for footing under column B, it's not sufficient. So you may keep one footing depth 300 mm and then increase another footing depth to 325 mm. It's okay now. But for discussion purpose only, I have adopted both depth as 350 mm. And if we use the 350 mm depth, then the footing is safe against two-way shear for both of our columns. And finally, we will check the depth from one-way shear also. Remember what we discussed in our last class. We discussed that, if you see this point here, we discussed that the base slab of the combined footing is subject to two-way bending and one-way as well as two-way shear. So what we have done up till now is we derived the depth of our footing and the required reinforcement based on bending, and then we checked that depth of our footing from two-way shear criteria. For two-way shear criteria, we adopted a different depth. So we got a different depth for two-way shear check, and now we will check our depth from one-way shear criteria as well. Let's see now here, the process is the same. You have to find the critical perimeter of critical section, and then you have to find the nominal shear stress developed for footing. If you remember, our critical section for two-way shear is at a distance of d by 2 from the face of the column. But for one-way shear, this will lie at a distance of d from the face of the column. So calculate this perimeter of critical section for both footings in the same way. I will provide you with this Excel sheet, so you can look at the formula that I have used here to calculate the perimeter of critical section. And after calculating the perimeter, calculate the nominal shear stress developed in the same way. The ultimate shear force that we got from the shear force diagram divided by perimeter into depth, you get the value of 0.47 and 0.52, which is less than 1.11. So it's also safe in one-way shear. And remember that our two-way shear or punching shear governs the depth of our footing. Since the depth obtained from the bending moment criteria is not sufficient to satisfy the punching shear criteria, so we adopted a higher depth while checking two-way shear from punching shear or two-way shear criteria, and using that depth we checked from one-way shear criteria and the check is satisfied. So two-way shear or punching shear governs the depth of footing. So finally, the details of our footing comes as below. Effective depth 350 mm. Bar diameter we have used 16 mm. So overall depth will be 480 mm in both cases. The reinforcement provided is area is here. The number of bars will be 12 and 19. In footing A and footing B respectively, and the spacing will be along the breadth, spacing will be this, and along the length, spacing will be this. So you can calculate the spacing also. When I provide you with this Excel sheet, check the formula that I have used to calculate the spacing here. So our design of the footing slab part is complete. Now we will go through the design of strap beam. Now, design of a strap beam is similar to the design of any other beam. So, I will not take much time for this strap beam design part. First, what we have done is we have assumed the depth and width of our beam. Generally, the width of our beam is assumed to be equal to or greater than the width of our column. If you assume the width of the beam to be equal to width of our column, then you may face some difficulty while placing the reinforcement. So, you may assume the width of the beam a little bit greater than the width of our columns. For now, I have assumed the same, that is 300 mm, and depth I have assumed 600 mm here. Remember, because of high shear forces coming onto this strap beam, shear reinforcement is required in large amount. So I have at the very beginning assumed the higher depth of our beam, 600 mm. Clear cover, I have assumed 35 mm. You may increase this. Now ultimate bending moment in beam and ultimate shear force in beam, I have written here 257 and 155. This is the value that you get from the same ETAPS model. We know that this middle portion is our beam part. So from this, if you scroll for values in your ETAPS model or SAP 2000 model, you will get the value of shear force. And again, this middle portion is our beam portion. So if you again scroll for values in your bending moment diagram in ETAPS, then you can get the value of bending moment coming onto your beam. So I did the same and got the value of ultimate bending moment, 257.97 kilonewton meter, and ultimate shear force 155.77 kilonewton. And for this depth and width of our section, if you calculate the ultimate limiting moment using this formula, I have already discussed about this formula, then you get the limiting moment to be 287.28 kilonewton meter for the beam of this width and depth. So since our limiting moment is greater than the ultimate bending moment coming onto our beam, we can design the beam as singly reinforced beam. So now for calculating the reinforcement in singly reinforced beam, use the same formula that we used here, this formula here. You have the every value that you need here. Use this formula to get the value of reinforcement coming into your strap beam. You get 1183.4 millimeter square. So the area of tension reinforcement provided is, if you provide 4 number of 20 mm die bars, you get the area to be 1257 millimeter square, which is greater than 1183.4 millimeter square, and hence okay. So remember, this is a singly reinforced beam and this is the tension reinforcement provided. If you see at your bending moment diagram, you see that negative moment is being developed in your beam part. So this tension reinforcement will be provided at the top and nominal bars will be provided at the bottom of the beam. Remember this, because of the negative moment, your beam will deflect in this pattern, so that tension will come at the top and compression at the bottom. Hence our tension zone lies at the top of this beam. And hence you have to provide this 4 number of 20 mm die bars at the top, and at the bottom you just have to provide nominal bar for shear reinforcement, because you need these hanger bars to tie your stirrups. If you want to check this, you can check this. For example, we have the formula for Yaksu max, which is the maximum depth of neutral axis, 0.456 into depth of your beam. And then you have the value for depth of neutral axis Yaksu. This formula you know from your undergraduate classes also. You get the value of Yaksu to be 253.17. Since the value of Yaksu is less than Yaksu max, your section is under reinforced. So you don't have to design your compression reinforcement. You can just put nominal reinforcement for compression reinforcement. And finally, after designing for longitudinal bar, you have to design for shear reinforcement of your beam. So there are three cases, tau V, tau C and tau C max. Remember, here are three symbols. This tau V is the nominal shear force that is coming onto your beam. Tau C is the design shear strength, and tau C max is the maximum shear stress. The value of tau C max depends on your grade of concrete. So for M20 grade, 2.8 Newton per mm square. You have to calculate the value of tau V by yourself, and the value of tau C you get from table 19 in your IS code. Get the value of tau V, tau C and tau C max and compare which case does it satisfy. For example, tau C max you get 2.8. Tau V is the ultimate shear force into 1000 divided by B into dV. We have this value of VU, B and dV, which is 0.8654. And this tau c value which you get from table 19, we get to be 0.544. I do not want to go into detail about tau c. Go to table 19 and you can calculate yourself. Now you see that our tau c max is 2.8 is greater than tau v, 0.8654, and this tau v is greater than tau c, 0.544. So our case 2 is satisfied. Now we have to design the shear stirrups. This nominal shear stirrups won't be sufficient. Remember, we have assumed 600 mm depth of your beam. If your depth of the beam is smaller, then your tau c max will be lesser than tau v. That is, tau v, the shear stress that is coming onto your beam will be greater than the limiting value of shear stress. In that case, you may have to redesign the section. That means increase the depth of your beam. So at the very beginning, I have assumed a greater depth. So we have gone into case 2. Now we have to provide shear stirrups by design. Now we have to provide shear stirrups not for the whole shear stress, but for this value of shear stress only, tau v minus tau c, which you get to be 0.3214. This is the shear stress, hence the shear force is this value Ts or tau s into B into dV by 1000, which is 57.84 kilonewton. Now, using this shear force value, you can design two-legged stirrup. If we assume that the diameter of our stirrup is 8 mm, so that we get the area of each leg to be 50.286 mm square, you can get the spacing is this formula, 0.87 FY ASV. We have got here dV 600 mm, VUS 57.84. You get your spacing should be 226.91 mm. So use 8 mm dia, two-legged stirrups. Now, spacing we have got 226. Let us check for spacing also. Our spacing should be least of these three. 0.75 into depth, which will get to be 0.450 mm, 300 mm, and 0.87 FYSV by 0.4B, which is 822.54. So the minimum value is 300 mm. Hence, our spacing should not be greater than 300 mm. Now, since we have got this spacing as 226.91, use the same spacing, or you may decrease your spacing also. That will not affect your design. So finally, for strap beam also, we have completed our design of longitudinal bar and design of transverse reinforcement. In this way, we have completed the design of our eccentric footing. So this is our final design figure. This is our eccentric footing. The dimension is almost square. This is our interior footing. I have just changed this position from here to here. The dimension width is 1.87 and length is 2.25. And the width of our strap beam is 300 mm. The depth is 600 mm. The longitudinal reinforcement is 420 mm dia bars, which are placed at the top since we have negative moment coming onto our beam. And shear reinforcement is 8 mm dia, two-legged stirrups at about 220 mm spacing. Similarly, the reinforcement in our footing part is 19 number of 12 mm dia bars for this eccentric footing, and 19 number of 16 mm dia bars, and 12 number of 16 mm dia bars for this interior or concentric footing. So in this way, you can complete the design of your eccentric footing along with a strap beam. If we have completed this video and you may not understand the process fully by watching this video once, so go through this video more than once, twice, thrice, if it becomes necessary, and I will provide you with this Excel sheet. If you go simultaneously with my Excel sheet and this video, then it won't be difficult for you to design this strap beam. It is a comparatively longer process, so it may take some time to understand. So in our next video, we will continue with this design of strap footing and eccentric footing, but in our safe software. So this much for today. We'll meet again soon. Thank you.